Okay, so we have here Dr. Rhonda Green, and she's been talking about a bioblitz in our deluge, a success despite the weather. Thank you.
Yes, I'm chair of the Scenic Rim branch of the Wildlife Preservation Society of Queensland, which is quite a lengthy title to say. Sorry, how do I advance the slide? Just press the downward button? Yeah. Okay, so just to show you where it is, it's one of Australia's hot spots of biodiversity, but a lot of our local population doesn't really appreciate that. They don't know what's at their doorstep. And although it's so close to Brisbane and the Gold Coast with all its universities, it hasn't really been as well investigated as it might. This McPherson-Macleay overlap, that's one of the big hot spots there. We get a lot of the southernmost limits of southern species, and it's one of the things that gives, I think it's about the third highest biodiversity within Australia. So, why a bioblitz? Well, I got inspired at the inaugural conference of this association, before it became an association, I think, back in Canberra a couple of years ago. I went to a bioblitz workshop. Wanted to get local people more aware of wonderful stuff all around them. Thought, well, because it's been less studied than it should be, we might find some rare species, maybe even some new species, new to science as well as records for the region, could assist planning for future research. We've got honours students, master students, PhD students from universities in Brisbane and Gold Coast always looking for new research projects, as well as the established researchers. Maybe what we find there could act as a basis for planning and assist conservation planning. This is the main reason we went to council for a grant. Conservation management, where do we need enhancement of habitat in the isolated, fragmented bits, where we might need habitat corridors and so on. And also to provide educational tools. I mean, the kids in our local schools, they know about giraffes and elephants and so on. They don't know a lot about antechinuses or a lot of the other creatures, bristlebirds and things that we have in our own backyard. And to add to databases like iNaturalist and Atlas of Living Australia. So why Tambourine Mountain? Well, we've got different habitats up there. We've got rainforest and eucalypt forest, got different soil types, so different kinds of eucalypt forest, easy walking tracks, safe walking tracks for families, don't want anyone falling off cliffs or so on. Facilities, we had to bring people in, they need to park, there's accommodation for those coming from afar, restaurants, and possibility of rare species. One that we hoped to find was the Atacinus subtropicus, which some of the threatened species people are looking for. Okay, so we planned it months in advance. We got 3,300 from the local council. The land key people came on board. Skywalk, which is a tourism place that takes people through a canopy walk through the rainforest. Thunderbird Park, which has adventure things like fossicking and so on. It also has a huge area of rainforest and eucalypt forest. They all came on board really enthusiastically, got hold of this and distributed it to our members, and a lot of planning. We got a lot of good, really good experts joining in. Roger Kitching, Robert White, you might know his book on spiders. I won't go through them all because limited time, but yeah, we got a lot of really good people from universities and museum and authors of relevant books. So and we arranged, we joined iNaturalist, or I'd already joined that, I joined ALA, got our student who we were employing to feed in data, because it's a very time consuming process when you have a lot of data. So everything was going really well. We promoted it widely, had posters and flyers and ads in the paper. We got a mention, front page of Tambourine Times, a lot of social media. And we got some well-known people. Frank is responsible for all those chocolate bilbies you see in supermarkets now, and some of them contribute towards Save the Bilby Fund, some don't, unfortunately. But yeah, Frank has done wonderful work with conservation. He opened it for us, Pat Conbin and Nadia O'Carroll. I introduced them as two of my favourite politicians because they were both amateur naturalists before they became politicians. I introduced Pat as being the first environment minister we ever had in Queensland who knew what ecology actually meant. And Nadia, deputy mayor of the scenic rim, she's been very supportive. Judith Rowland from Tambourine Mountain Land Care, she was very, very supportive as well. And we arranged for a well-known wildlife artist to do a painting that people could watch, a local group that keeps wildlife that native to the region to introduce our volunteers to. And for weeks, we'd had a drought. We'd had bright, sunny days for weeks. Excellent for getting things like this, the Richmond birdwing butterfly, second biggest butterfly, and very, very beautiful. Then 2 days before it opened, it rained, just kept raining, including the entire 48 hours of bio blitz. A lot of families and a lot of individuals had added to our database of people interested, wanted to be kept on update, so were going to come, and they didn't come. Some did still, but a lot didn't. The dragonfly experts said, oh, dragonflies don't fly in this weather, and they left after the opening. So did one of the birding experts. Even a moss expert. Look, mosses love rain, don't they? There was a guy that was going to lead spotlight, a good amateur naturalist who leads a lot of spotlighting walks on the mountain, but he unfortunately, he had a cancer which is in remission, but he didn't want to risk his health walking on a wet night, so that was reasonable, of course. So he didn't lead, but there were a couple of others that did lead walks both nights. We abandoned the idea of pitfall traps, didn't want to be drowning any animals. We couldn't use the bat detector that someone had brought along that was connected to his own computer because he didn't want that getting wet. But we did hire, I'll get on that in a minute. Yeah. Those of us that did stay, a lot of us got very wet. But a reasonable crowd did come from the opening. Frank has also had, he's only got one kidney, he's had other health problems. And he drove all the way down from Toowoomba to join us. I thought, oh, what if only four or five people turn up with this weather? It was just pelting down. But you can see we did almost fill the marquee that council provided for us. And after the talks, a lot of us did head out into the rain. And we had to be very careful where we set Elliot traps. I mostly set them under the buildings. Second night also under logs and under palm trees and other sheltered areas. And we did catch long-nosed bandicoots and fawn-footed melimus. And on our spotlighting walks, we saw a few other mammals. The second night, we set up, and it's like an anabat, but it's called a song meter. And the bats didn't seem to mind the rain. These are the species that we definitely detected, and the last two were not quite sure. Our motion sensing cameras, which we also had to find sheltered spots for, also got a few animals. That's a little melimus down the bottom left there, got interested in the camera. We've got 70 native bird species, plus a couple of exotics, even though it was raining. We found a few lizards, including these lovely little leaf-tailed geckos. It was good for frogs. We saw, I think, three or four species and heard the others. Roger Kitching, our moth expert, he's chair of ecology at Griffith University, surprisingly told us moths love rain. I thought, butterflies don't, why do moths? But they do. I thought it'd be good to get 50 moths, it'd be good to get 20 species. We got over 500, we didn't collect. Mostly this was observational, but Roger said there's no way that you can identify most of the moths without actually having them under the microscope. And he said, conservation-wise, there's no way he'd be doing this if he thought it was going to really affect the population out there. So he and his volunteers, over 500 trapped during the bio blitz. including they've only gone through about half of them so far, but they found almost 180 species, some of them new to science. These are some of them that have already been identified and set out. The dragonfly people that left, they came back a couple of days later when the sun came out. And you can see there, we've got quite a good list of dragonflies. The spider experts, spider experts found a few new species. One of them has been named after our land care person, something or other Judith Rolandii it's going to be. Got some lovely spiders. Crustaceans were out, so were mollusks at night. This earthworm, which is about so long, I don't think you would have seen him if it wasn't raining. The moss expert came back and identified a whole lot of moths and liverworts. And the fungi people found a lot of species. They gave up after a while. They were slipping too much trying to get to them, but they came back a few days later and got more. And, you can, if you look up scenicrim.wildlife.org.au, you can see our results. And so what happens now? Well, I've just sent in a 44-page report. Did you want to film that website? Did you get that? Okay. I've just sent a 44-page report to Council and to some of our helpers and our experts. A large part of our grant, or about a third of it, I think, went to a very good Griffith Uni student to feed in data to iNaturalist and Atlas of Living Australia. One of the appendices to the report is giving clues to teachers how to use this information, not just a species list, but this is what you can do, telling your students about biodiversity, about animal-plant interactions, etc. And the moth experts and the fungi experts said, we'd love to come back in autumn and see what's happening. So we're actually running another 48-hour bio blitz in the middle of next month, and we had our final workshop after the bio blitz, and we're still communicating and refining lessons based on this one. For instance, a lot of people haven't heard about it despite all our advertising. So now we're putting flyers in doctors' offices and veterinary and Animal Welfare League op shops and all sorts of other places. Also, we're planning for all sorts of weather and using waterproof signs to show people where to go, because we had a little trouble with that. Finally, if you're all set to start, heavy rains start to fall, don't let the end of the story be, then it rained and they all went home, but it rained, they stayed, and we achieved a lot.